Hi again, Mark here from Talking Bass. Today we're going to look at an absolute classic that I consider one of the greatest bass lines of all time by one of the greatest bass players of all time. It's the song I Was Made to Love Her by Stevie Wonder, and the bass line is played by the legendary James Jamerson. As always, the lesson material is all there over at talkingbass.net. Just click the link in the info below. Also, like the video, subscribe to the channel, and leave a comment below. Then remember to check out the totally free membership over at Talking Bass. Talking Bass is now a complete social network for bass players. Just log in and you'll be able to connect with over 100,000 other bass players from all over the world in the forums, groups, and chat rooms. It's very much like Facebook, but for bass players, but with the addition of over 450 free bass lessons, a ton of free practice resources, and a set of ebook downloads, such as the Scale Reference Manual. Then, if you want to take things further, there are the premium courses on everything from beginner bass, to reading music, scales, chord tones, slap bass, ear training, and much, much more. So sign up today, and remember, it's totally free to join a great bass community. James Jamerson really needs no introduction. He was the in-house bass player for Motown Records through the 1960s and early 70s, and played on all those classic hits by the Supremes, the Temptations, the Four Tops, Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, Martha Reeves, and many, many more. He had a distinctive bass tone and style that contributed heavily to the Motown sound, and he was a massive influence on nearly all bass players that followed. His effortless melodic weaving through chord progressions would shape the playing of everyone from Paul McCartney to Jaco Pastorius to John Entwistle to Marcus Miller. Literally every influential bass player of the last 50 years speaks of the impact that James Jamerson had on their playing. Jamerson had a background as an upright jazz player before moving on to electric, and this influenced a lot of his trademark style, especially his use of open strings, ghost notes, and chromatic lines, as we'll see in this breakdown. Today I'm using a Fender Precision 50s reissue strung with labella flat wounds just like James, and I'm also using a Nordy mute to deaden the strings in much the same way as the rubber mute on his bridge cover. So the combination of the mute, the flat wounds, and the P bass all help to get that Jamerson bouncy upright on electric vibe. I Was Made to Love Her is a great example of every aspect of James Jamerson's style, and it's an absolute masterclass in Motown bass playing. We're going to work through the intro and opening verse that sounds like this. First of all, let's learn that introductory line that sounds like this. So we're in the key of F major, and we begin on an F, 8th fret of the A string, and I'm fretting that with the middle finger, the second finger there. That keeps me in position for the remainder of the notes. So then we move up to the C at the 10th fret of the D string, played twice. Okay, then up to the D at the 7th fret of the G string. And then we've got two hits on the F up at the 10th fret of the G string. Then just D, C, D. Okay, so D, 7th fret, G string, 10th fret, D string, and 7th fret, G string again. Just round and round. That's very much a Motown feel there, because we've got that sixth in there. You'll hear a lot of sixths in a lot of these Motown lines. That note there, that's the major sixth, and you've got it here again. So root, fifth, major sixth, and the octave. Okay? Now there is a fill at the end of those two bars, which we'll come back to later, but for now let's move on to the main bass line. So this song has a recurring chord progression through nearly the entire thing, with the exception of a few bars in the middle section. And before learning any of the bass lines, I'd recommend just memorizing that simple chord sequence so you're aware of what's going on in terms of the harmony. So this is going to help a lot with, you know, memorizing the lines. So for the chord progression, we've got F major, then B flat minor 7 to E flat 7, then D flat major, E flat major, and F major, okay? Okay, so you'll have to excuse the muted sound. It's not particularly good for chords. And don't worry, you don't need to learn the chords, but you do need to learn as chord tones. You want to know what those chords are so you can just play through it with the bass line. So one thing you can do here is just try playing through with the root notes. So let's say we take the F here at the 8th fret of the A string, then B flat, E flat. So that's the 6th fret E string and 6th fret on the A string. So B flat, E flat, and then D flat, E flat, and back to the F. Okay, so D flat, 4th fret of the A string, then the E flat at the 6th fret, and then back up to the F at the 8th fret. Okay, very simple. That's all we've got. Okay, so. You also want to try playing those root notes in the lower areas. So I started on this F up here, but if we start on the F down here, and then B flat, E flat, so first fret on the A string and D string, and then again we can just play D flat and E flat leading up, okay? Or D flat and then the E flat here, so D flat, E flat, F. Now, just as a little breakdown of what that chord progression is doing there, we've got the F major, which is chord one. We're in the key of F major. Then we've got this B flat to E flat seven, okay? Now, really what you want to do with this chord progression, if you're going to analyze it, is to just see it as F major, E flat, D flat, E flat, and back to F. That's a good way of seeing the overall structure. Very simple, F, just going down in whole steps and then back up, okay? And that's pretty much F major, and then these other chords are borrowing from the parallel minor, so borrowing from F minor. It's a very, very common move. You don't have to worry about all this parallel minor stuff, really. It's just this nice lead up. Now the B flat minor 7 comes into play as a transition from the F major down to this E flat, which we're playing as an E flat 7. So it's creating this temporary 2-5 feel, which again is a very common move in chord progressions. Okay. And that's pretty much it. So now I'm just gonna play along to the track, and I'm gonna play the intro riff and then move into the main chord progression, just playing those root notes. And bear in mind that you can play around on this as much as you want, just adding notes in there. Start adding some fifths, start adding some thirds. And that's a good way of learning to kind of weave lines through these progressions. Then when you come to analyze Jamerson's lines, you can see how far you can take this as a master of the instrument. So with the backing track we have, maybe a few fifths. Okay. Next, we need to look at the chord tones available to us through this progression. These are the arpeggios of the chords, and it's important to understand these notes because the bass line is going to be working around them as the basic framework. Yes, he uses a lot of chromatic passing notes and things like that, but it's all based around a solid chord tone framework. And this is the secret to creating melodic bass lines through a progression. Jamerson was an upright jazz player, so knew this all too well from improvising walking bass lines. So I won't waste time by working through all the basic fundamentals of chord construction. I've covered all of that stuff many, many times here on the channel. Instead, let's just look at what we have here. So we start with the chord F major, so you want to know the F major triad. Then we have B flat minor 7, so, and it's worth knowing it, you know, all over that area. E flat 7. Then we come up D flat major. Okay, so it's just learning the arpeggios of each of those chords. Like I said, there's not many of them. F major, you learn that major triad. D flat, E flat, and we've got the B flat minor 7 or B flat minor, you know, thrown in there for good measure. So a lot of this bass line is improvised, but there are some bars in there that are pre-composed or more generally prescriptive. First, we have the fourth bar of each progression where we repeat the opening line. Okay, so we have that there on the fourth bar. And we also have a prescribed line for the ascending D flat and E flat chords that sounds like this. Okay, so we're coming up through those two chords, D flat major and E flat major. And what do you know? It's the triads that we were just looking at. So D flat major, D flat, F, and then A flat. So fourth fret, A string, then third fret and sixth fret on the D string. Then we have a chromatic approach on the D natural, fifth fret of the A string, to lead up into the E flat triad. So E flat, G and B flat. So sixth fret on the A string, then fifth fret and eighth fret on the D string. And then we play two notes on the F to lead us into the riff. So. Okay, so that becomes the third and fourth bars for each chord sequence as we move along. So now let's try again with the track. I'll play the intro and then I'll play the basic root notes up to that third and fourth bar where I'll put in our prescribed lines. Next, we get to move into the real genius of James Jamerson and the absolute beauty of his playing style as we look at how he improvises his lines on the first two bars of each sequence. We'll start with the opening line after the intro that sounds like this. So it's important to note when learning Jamerson's lines that he makes use of open strings a lot. And this is probably a result of his upright background, and it means you have to bear it in mind when working out a fingering. So for this first bar, we have. Okay, this is such a crazy cool line. So very slowly. So what's happening here is we're moving from the F to the B flat. So we're starting on the F at the third fret of the D string, and it's a this weaving line that eventually lands on the B flat. So we've got the F, and then we've got the open D string, and then down to the C natural third fret of the A string. Then we have this ascent from the open D string again up to the F. So D, D sharp, E, F. So this is open string, first fret, second fret, third fret. Very simple, chromatic ascent. So, and then we have this line leading into the B flat, which is pretty much a bit of a chromatic enclosure. So we start on the A natural, the open string again, then C, C flat, and the B flat there. So, you could see the C flat as the B natural as well, obviously. So A, C, C flat, B flat. Okay, so open string on the A string, 3rd fret, 2nd fret, 1st fret. Okay, so. In terms of the rhythm, this is all 16th note based, and it's the reason that many bass students are given Jamerson lines as recommended reading practice. For the rhythm, we've got a hit on beat 1, and then we've got a hit on the A of beat 2. So 1 E under 2 E and A. Okay, so it's the last 16th note of beat 2. So 1 E under 2 E and A. Then for 3 and 4, all of the 16th notes. 3 E and A, 4 E and A. So very slowly, 1 E and A, 2 E and A, 3 E and A, 4 E and A. Okay, so that one's fairly straightforward, but they're gonna get trickier as we go on. So now if we put the notes and the rhythms together, we get the following. 3 and 4 and 1 E and A, 2 E and A, 3 E and A, 4 E and A, 1. Okay, and that leads us into the B flat. 3, 4. Okay, so when you build up speed, you can hear it gets a lot more tricky. For the second bar, we have the B flat minor 7 to E flat 7 that sounds like this. Okay, leading up to the D flat. So, we're on the B flat minor 7, playing the root note and then the fifth, the F. So the F there at the 3rd fret of the D string. So, play the B flat twice and then the F. And then we're on the E flat. We're anticipating that. Then we have this little fill, for want of a better word, just lead us into the D flat. So we're on the E flat there, the E flat 7 chord, and we come down E flat, B flat, A natural. So E flat, 1st fret on the D string, 1st fret on the A string, then the open A string, and then the A flat at the 4th fret of the E string. And Jamerson does this a lot where he plays, instead of playing, you know, playing it all as a single kind of pattern, you know, that kind of will make more sense visually, he actually puts the open string in there and then the next note down on another string. So it's kind of different to how a lot of bass players see it, you know, because you've got to think, okay, I'm here, I've got the open A string and then the 4th fret. Most people would think like that, you know, coming down 6-5-4 on the fret. He doesn't. Okay, and I think this is a lot to do with the hook, you know, is one finger use, so. So, we're coming down the root note and the fifth of the E flat, and then we've got this little chromatic note leading us into the A flat, which is pretty much an implication of an A flat major chord. A flat to C, major third there, so we've got A flat, 4th fret, E on the E string, and then the C at the 3rd fret of the A string. See there, that's this A flat major leading into the D flat. Okay, so we're kind of implying an A flat. Now that is pretty much tonicization. It's pretty much a, you know, we're implying the dominant chord leading into the D flat almost as a chord one. Don't worry about any of the theory there. It's just, you know, we're just leading into the D flat. So we have. So you really want to take that slowly. Even slower. Okay? So the whole line there sounds like this. Now, I've mentioned a few times how Jamerson was heavily influenced on electric by his upright jazz playing, and these melodic lines are a great example of that. For instance, the chromatic movement in this line, okay, that sounds really busy and, you know, all over the place, can be simplified rhythmically so it becomes more like this. That's the basic structure of the line, and that's a very common walking bass figure. And it's easy to see how he's pretty much taking his walking bass style and mixing it up with 16th note syncopation to get a totally unique and pioneering sound. Now, before trying this line to a track, it's worth mentioning the fill that Jamerson uses to lead from the intro riff to the first main bass line. It's at the end of the second bar, and it sounds like this. Okay, so we've got the second bar. We end up at the C at the 10th fret of the D string, and then we have these three notes. So we've got the open G string, then the F and the C, third fret on the D string and A string. And so Jamerson's using that open G string as a way of transitioning from this higher area where we played that intro riff into this lower area where we can play all those cool open string 16th note runs. The note G works fine with the fill, but even if it didn't, it wouldn't matter too much because it's pretty much acting as a ghost note or a skip, while the F and the C, the other two thirds of that line, are the main chord tones. So it's quite tricky to get it, you know, but it is a descending line and you can rake across it, you know, using the hook, you know, using that one finger, or you can use two fingers, you know. So, okay, so that's the line, very, very slowly. Okay. Now, it's also worth mentioning that at the end of those four bars that we just learned, he plays the riff, and instead of moving back up to the D up here, he actually plays the low E here to lead back into the F. So he's playing the E, which I'm playing here at the seventh fret of the A string. He might have played it down here at the second fret, but that is quite a jump. I suspect that he played the E here and then played the F here at the eighth fret of the A string, and then in the next line that you'll see in a second, he uses the open D string to transition. So a lot of this open string stuff is all about transitioning from one area to the other, okay? So just at the end of that line we had. Okay. So now I'll try the intro and those first four bars with the track, and I'm gonna work through different speeds. So we're gonna try it 78 beats per minute to begin with. So here we are. Okay, now let's try a little faster. I'm going to try 88 beats per minute. Finally, let's try at 98 beats per minute. Now, I've specified 98 as being the kind of full speed, but it moves around a lot on the original, and you'll often see it as 103 beats per minute, which it does reach, but there is a lot more kind of laid back a feel, and you'll notice that if you try playing this to any tracks at 103 beats per minute, it just feels too fast. So I've put it at 98 just to give it a little bit more laid back feel, and it's a bit easier for learning it. So here it is at 98. Now we're going to pick up speed a little bit because we've covered the intro and then we've covered the first line over that instrumental section. The vocals now enter and we're going to have four reiterations of this chord sequence, and things are going to be very, very similar. The main changes are going to be on those first two bars, so we'll be able to work through them a lot quicker. So the next line sounds like this. So at the end of the previous line, we ended on this F here at the 8th fret of the A string, and then we have the following. So we've got the open D string, which I'm using to transition, then 1st fret, 2nd fret, and 3rd fret. So D, D sharp, E, F, okay? So, then we've got open A, C, 3rd fret of the A string, and then we're to the B flat at the 1st fret. So. And now we have this more simplified section where we have, so this is the B flat to the E flat section, so B flat minor 7 to E flat 7. We've got B flat, first fret of the A string, and then F, then E, and E flat. So first fret A string, and then third fret, second fret, first fret on the D string. So simple root, fifth, and then chromatic passing note leading into the E flat. Okay, just a simple transition into the from the B flat to the E flat. So all of that. and then we finish off with the lead up into the D flat. So we've got B flat, A flat, C, and D flat. So again, we're making use of that A flat to C. So that's the that little A flat major to D flat that I was talking about, but we've got the B flat there, the fifth of the E flat. So very straightforward, just another lead into the D flat. But, you know, it's a different one from before, so you've got to, you know, you've got to work on it. So we have. Rhythmically, the only thing you have to worry about here is in the second beat. So we have a hit on beat one, and then in beat two, we've got this 16th, 8th, 16th note rhythm, which is quite a syncopated rhythm of two E and A, okay? One E and a, two E and A, okay? One E and a, two E and A, okay? So one E and a, two E and A, or one, two E, A. So it's pretty much offbeat 16th notes there. But if you listen to it, you'll be able to hear that rhythm and try and get it. Now, if you're not used to syncopated 16th notes or your rhythm's not very good, often you'll end up quantizing these things. You know, if you hear somebody that's not been playing very long, when they try these kind of rhythms like that, you know, these kind of offbeat 16th notes, it all ends up getting, quantized to the nearest eighth note or quarter note. So you really need to subdivide to be able to hear how these things work. And this is where learning to read actually comes in really, really, really handy, because if you can read music, you decipher all this stuff. You get used to seeing these subdivisions and counting like this, okay? So that's the only bit that's going to be tricky. So one E and a, two E and A, and then the rest of that, three and four and, okay? One last thing to bear in mind, and this applies for all the remaining iterations, is that when we play the riff at the end, get up to the D at the end, and then we have an open G string. That open G string is acting again as a skip to get us down to this F. Okay, so, and you can hear it quite plainly as a G. Now you have a choice. You can either pick it individually, so, you know, and, you know, he'll be raking down onto it, or, and he might be doing this because this is used a lot on upright, he could be pulling off, you know, using one of those, you know, I'm exaggerating it there, but using a pull off as a skip, which is used a lot in walking bass lines, just to get us down here. So, okay, so that's another way of doing it. I tend to do it just picking it, you know, but you've got the choice. So now I'll just play through everything we've covered so far so you can hear how the transitions work from line to line. So, three, four. So the next line sounds like this. So as you can hear, bars 2, 3, and 4 are pretty much the same. In the second bar, we've got E flat, B flat, C to lead up into the D flat major, so nothing particularly interesting there. E flat and B flat, they're the chord tones on the E flat, and then we've got this approach note of C natural leading into the D flat, so that gets that out of the way. But the main thing here is the first bar, where we've got loads of these open strings, okay? So we start off, okay, so we've got two hits on the F, so two eighth notes, which is different from the previous ones where we only played one, so. So then open D string, C at the third fret of the A string, and then open A string. Okay, so. Then back up to the open D string, then to the C again at the third fret of the A string. Then E to F, second fret to third fret on the D string. And then the good old A, C, C flat, B flat, the same as we've played in all of the other bars. So open A string, third fret, second fret, first fret on the A string. So, that's our way of getting to that B flat. So again, pretty much the same kind of thing, but this time we're starting on the root note and then very quickly descending via the sixth down to the third. So we're very much accenting the third there. So, you know, a bit of a change up. This is how he's creating variation on this line, because he doesn't want to play the same thing throughout, you know. And I mean, it is pretty amazing that he gets through this entire tune and barely repeats. You know, it's always with the same kind of thematic thing, but he's working around it in subtle ways. And, you know, it's just, like I say, it's just astonishing that he gets through the whole thing naturally, improvising it. You know, he's not learning these lines. This is just all a part of his musicality. He's improvising through that chord progression and he's putting these lines in there. Rhythmically, as I mentioned earlier, we've got 2/8 notes at the beginning on beat one, so one and. Then for beats 2 and 3, we're on E and A. Okay, so it's the 2nd, 3rd, and 4th 16th notes. So let's have a listen to how that sounds. 1 and 2, E and A, 3, E and A, and then we have them all for the last 4, E and A. This is because we're tying over. So this is syncopated 16th note. So we're tying over 1 and, we hold that note across, and then we come in on the E. So 1 and 2, E and A. Let's take it even slower than that. 1 and 2, E and A, 3, E and A, 4, E and A. Which one you play a little faster? 1 and 2, E and A, 3, E and A, 4, E and A. So you just have to do it very, very slowly. And if you can do it slowly, you can eventually do it quicker. So 1 and 2, E and A, 3, E and A, 4, E and A. You just get used to the feel of that. And remember, you also have to do the ties across. So this is all amazing practice at playing 16th note syncopations or 16th note lines. So let's put all of that together again. So 3, 4. And again, at the end, we've got that little skip to get us back down to that F. For the next line, we've got the following. So, once again, we've got a bit of an open string fest with all of these open strings. So, we've got two Fs there, 8th notes again at the beginning, so 3rd fret of the D string. Then we play it again to lead into these two notes, the open A string and the open D string. Now, a lot of you might find that quite odd, playing across the neck with open strings, but because I'm using the mute here, and because, you know, you can use rest stroke moving up, it actually, you know, it works fine, and it also almost becomes a bit of a percussive thing with the fingers, so. And then, same kind of line that we played before, C, 3rd fret of the A string, and then open D string, D sharp, E, F, leading up, open A, C, C flat, B flat, same as we've played before. So it kind of sounds like the ones that we've played before. Like I was saying in the previous line, you know, it's all based around this general theme, but it's subtly different. This one, again, it is different. You know, you've got those two open strings in there, and then that same line, I mean, that line there leading in, the chromatic enclosure down to the B flat, that remains the same pretty much. But like I say, it's all subtle, and it just means that it's an ever-changing thing as it works through. In the second bar, same as always, and then we have B flat, A flat, C. So again, we've got that implication of the A flat major, and we've got the 5th of the E flat there. So same line we've played before, leading us into the D flat. So it's only the first bar that's of interest here. So, let's hope. And for the final line, we have the following. So just as in the last line, we've got the two Fs, and then as we've done before, we've got the open D to the C at the 3rd fret of the A string and back. So that's our little move there. But then we have a slightly less dense rhythm of E flat to the E, just quavers or eighth notes. So, okay, so. Then we've got the same line that we've played before, F, and then open A, C, C flat, and then to the B flat. So it's just that beginning bit that's different. So it's just a little bit less dense. And like I said, thematically, it's all working, but this time he's playing with the rhythm just to make it sound a little bit different, okay? And then at the end of, after we've played the that line, we have an ascent into the D flat of G natural, B flat, C. So we're on the E flat 7, so we're actually playing an inversion here. We've got the third of the chord, the G there this time, then the B flat, which is the fifth, and then up to the C as a just a basic half step approach into the D flat. So, okay, so the whole line. Okay, so you can hear out there G, B flat, C leading up again, just a subtle change. You know, it's that improvisation in there, keeping that theme running, but just subtly different. Okay, so that's a little look at I Was Made to Love Her. Hopefully, this will have inspired you to work through the whole tune, gradually adding more and more lines to the ones that we've covered. And like I said, it's a true masterclass in bass playing, and it's a really hard tune to get through with complete authenticity, you know, whatever your level. So with that in mind, I'd recommend buying the Hal Leonard book, Standing in the Shadows of Motown, The Life and Music of Legendary Bassist James Jamerson. It's chock-a-block full of Jamerson transcriptions, and it contains a ton of info regarding his life and influences, and it's one of the best bass books that you can buy, period. Also, remember that over at the website, I've got three different tracks at different speeds, so you can try these lines, adding them, you know, trying them in isolation, whatever it is that you want to do, you can go over to the site and you can try them at all of those three different speeds. As always, like, comment, and subscribe to the channel, then check out the lesson material and track over at the Talking Bass website, where you can enroll free in the Talking Bass Network membership. Okay, I'll see you next week.